Hello and welcome to Murder with Friends, the show where two friends get together and talk about the darker sides of history. I'm your host, Grace Baldridge, and joining me today is my friend and Twitch variety streamer, Jennifer Roberts.
Hi.
Is your name?
Hello, that is my name.
But people might know you as
Ghostbird.
Yeah.
Because I stream on Twitch, a delightful online platform for nerds who want to play video games and share that with other nerds who like video games. So yeah, I go by Ghostbird on Twitch, but my viewers don't know my real name, but now they do.
Although it's a pretty big reveal.
You were on my stream months ago. You came to play music, and the first thing you did upon walking into my apartment is go, Jen!
So, yeah, I immediately doxed you.
You did.
I will admit to that. I did. I didn't know it was a thing at the time. But look, we're all about revealing identities and getting to the truth of things, which is why, kind of, that's a weird segue, you are on here today to talk about Jack the Ripper.
Yeah.
So I knew that I wanted to talk about Jack the Ripper with you because you gave me a book a while back that had something to do with Jack the Ripper. Tell us a little bit about that and your interest in this case.
Yeah, so I'm pretty fascinated with it just because it's a mystery. It's, you know, they never figured out who he was. So he's become this sort of icon that can be molded and put into lots of different stories. And one story that I liked a lot, it's this book called Name of the Star by Maureen Johnson. And she takes the idea of the Ripper and changes it to, well, what if the Ripper's ghost came back? And the story is about this girl who moves to London and the ghost starts wreaking havoc on London. And I found it really fascinating because we, as we'll get to, we don't know much about Jack the Ripper. So it's easy to sort of copy paste him into different fictional scenarios.
Yeah, I came in to this story knowing very little, but always wanting to educate myself. Last time I was in London, I took one of the Ripper walking tours because, as we're gonna get into, Jack the Ripper killed within this very walkable radius in the East End of London. And my tour guide happened to be a guy named Mick Priestley. And Mick, if you're watching, which I hope you are, wrote an amazing book that I actually got from this tour that was my guide for this episode today. It's called One Autumn in Whitechapel. I highly recommend it. It is one of the most researched true crime novels I have read. So with that in mind, I reached out to Mick to help us with this episode because it is an immense body of research that has been done on this case. The case theory is abundant. There's no way that you can just get into it on a little YouTube show, but I wanted as much help as I could. So I reached out to Mick and he's gonna be helping us with our video elements today. So that man that you're gonna be seeing later on is Mick. Thank you so much. Now, we begin our story on the east side of London in 1888. And what did this part of the city look like then? Was it glamorous?
I assume it looked a little bit like garbage. It's like not the great end of Hollywood. It was, what, 10 square blocks? And I think I heard somewhere that there were an estimated 1,200 prostitutes in Whitechapel around this time, which 1,200 prostitutes in a 10 square block radius. It's a lot.
Yeah, it was a poor part of London. It was not the fancy part of London. I think a lot of times when you hear about Jack the Ripper, you hear about, or you'll see it represented in the media of a bunch of gents walking around with top hats and it was these fancy people killing other fancy people.
Not in Whitechapel.
It's just not the case. And Jack the Ripper, as we'll get into, is preying on very high risk women. But let's just touch on some of the misconceptions. So let's go to Mick right now and talk about some of the misconceptions that maybe you have surrounding Jack the Ripper.
Now, in the time since the murders took place, an awful lot has been written about the case. A lot of documentaries have been made. A lot of movies have been filmed. But sadly, a lot of these things really aren't based in any kind of fact whatsoever. As a result, a lot of people have been led to believe numerous falsehoods and exaggerations and guesses as facts when they're really not. I think one of the biggest misconceptions that people have about the case and with Jack the Ripper is the way he's always portrayed, his image with his top hat and his expensive coat and his long expensive cape and his doctor's bag, when really at no point in the entire case was the killer ever described as looking anything like that at all. Quite a lot of people actually saw him, and he's always described as fitting the same sort of image each time. He's aged between 25 and 35, give or take, depending on who sees him. He's always wearing a flat cap, never a top hat. He had a mustache, he had a beard at one crime scene. For one incident, he was actually described as wearing a blue suede coat, but you would never see Jack the Ripper in a movie wearing a flat cap and a blue suede coat. But that was actually how he was described by some people who saw him. Also, another thing that people often tend to have in their minds is that the royal family was somehow involved, or that the police at the time believed that members of the royal family were somehow implicated in the murders, when this is just nonsense as well. That theory is actually based on a book that was written in the 1970s, and there's a lot of nonsense in the book, but it was a really big seller. So that's the one that based the movies on, the based the TV series on, and this kind of thing. So now, you kind of have two Jack the Rippers. There's the actual Jack the Ripper, and there's the modern day Jack the Ripper in popular culture with his top hat and his cape and his royal family connections. But nobody believed any of that at the time, and no serious researcher or anybody who knows anything about true crime today believes any of that for a second. Another thing that people often seem to believe is that the killer was a doctor or a surgeon, and that he had some sort of medical training, when really this isn't really accurate either. Dr. Phillips, when he performed the autopsy of Annie Chapman, he noted one injury to her abdomen that he believed must have been done by somebody who had some sort of medical or surgical training. But nobody else ever agreed with him, and there were a number of other doctors in the case. There was a Dr. Brown, a Dr. Bond, a Dr. Sequeira, a Dr. Saunders, who were all united in their belief that the killer showed no medical expertise whatsoever, not even the skill that would be required of a butcher or a horse slaughterer, they said. Plus, there are numerous other serial killers that we know of today who've done similar sort of things, and mutilations and organs being taken out. And off the top of my head, I can't think of a single one that was medically or surgically trained. Also, people often think that there were only five victims in the case. Really, that comes from that book in the 1970s as well. The royal family theory doesn't quite work if there's more than five murders and there's murders after Mary Kelly. The police at the time believed there were at least eight murders, and when you read the reports of these murders today with a modern eye on them, there were clearly at least eight murders as well. There was the murder of Martha Tabram on the 7th of August 1888, as well as the murders of Alice McKenzie on the 17th of July 1889, and that of Francis Coles on the 13th of February 1891. All of these murders at the time were attributed to the killer, and nowadays, really, when you see them in a modern context, it looks like this was clearly the same man committed all of these murders. But also, if you went back in time and you grabbed him and it really was him, he might have committed all sorts of other offenses that we don't know about, and for some reason just simply weren't attributed to him.
So, a whole lot of information to digest. Isn't Nick just like the coolest
He's
guy
so
ever?
He's so cool.
When he sent in those videos, I was just really stoked to do this episode, because it's rare that you get a legitimate expert on a show with friends in the title. I have amazing friends, yourself included.
Thank you.
Not a lot of them are experts. So it was very cool of Nick to help us out. With that being said, I think we should just get into who was killed and when. And I think the first thing that's important to note is that you will hear about the quote unquote, the canonical five, that these are the five victims, the official ones that were killed by Jack the Ripper. But in fact, when you go back and look at it, there were actually more than five that most people do assume or come to the conclusion were killed by Jack the Ripper. The first one being Martha Tabram, who was 39 years old, killed the 7th of August, 1888. And she fits the description of many of Jack the Ripper's victims, who were older prostitutes. Now, she, he also killed some younger women as well, but most of them were older, more vulnerable, more desperate. And then we get into the canonical five. Now, this is Marianne Nichols, who was killed on August 31st, 1888. Annie Chapman, who was killed on the 8th of September, 1888. And I actually have a video from Amir right now narrating a newspaper clipping that was taken from the time of the murder.
Another brutal murder of a woman in East London. Excitement in Whitechapel. On Saturday morning at 6:15, the neighborhood of Whitechapel was horrified to a degree bordering on panic by the discovery of another barbarous murder of a woman. The scene of the crime being 29 Hanbury Street into Brown Lane, Spitalfields. Hanbury Street is a thoroughfare running between Commercial Street and Whitechapel Road, the occupants of which are poor and for the most part of Jewish extraction. The circumstances of the murder are of such a revolting character as to point to the conclusion that it has been perpetrated by the hand which committed that in Bucks Row and the two other previous murders, all of which have occurred within a stone's throw of each other.
So you can hear early on people are on edge, and you can also hear that they are already associating the murder of Martha Tabram. They mentioned that with the murder of Annie Chapman. So it is strange that now in the 20th century, they throw out that one. They say, no, she's not one of the canonical five, when obviously at the time she was included in that number.
Yeah, I've thought about that. And I think that it has to be difficult to narrow down with the limited science and the limited, especially doing it in hindsight, the limited amount of information and the credibility of it, to say who was and wasn't a victim, because it was such a kind of a seedy area of London, and it was packed with people, and so I just don't know.
I also think at the time the police work wasn't quite there in the sense of establishing an MO of who the killer was and allowing a killer to evolve, as they so often do. The first kill, the one of Martha Tabram, is not going to be the same as it was when he killed Catherine Endos, which we're just about to get into. A killer is going to establish, okay, what is my fantasy? What do I want to do? I didn't do it right there. What, I still have this desire, this dark, twisting fantasy that I have yet to perfectly enact. What do I need to change? How do I want to evolve? Killers evolve. And I think that you see the police work at the time just being a little primitive in the sense of, well, this person was not killed the exact same way as this person, therefore it must not be the same killer.
Exactly.
But I don't find that correlation when you do take a modern eye.
If somebody's going to start killing, the first kill has to be a huge adrenaline rush because you've killed somebody. But then if you keep doing it, you're not going to get that same adrenaline rush. So you go bigger and you go bigger and you go bigger, as you see with a lot of killers. Things get more gruesome, more elaborate. And that's what happened by the end with Mary Kelly.
This is absolutely the pattern
that he
follows.
So I assume he started somewhere with just simply killing people and then decided that that wasn't enough of a rush for him. It wasn't doing it for him anymore. So then he started to get more gruesome and it became easier to group together his victims.
Right, and perhaps he had a fantasy that he couldn't yet name.
Yeah.
You know, he had this desire that he couldn't yet pinpoint, but it was more than just murder. It was more than just taking a life. There was something more to it. And we see this, just like you pointed out, Jen, that begins to act out. So there was the killing of Elizabeth Stride, which took place on the 30th of September, 1888. And those that were close to her at the time reportedly heard her saying, no, not tonight, dear, like turning away a man. She was also a prostitute. And this rejection may have spawned something in the killer, in Jack the Ripper, because this was a pretty, this was a really quick killing. This was definitely, the body wasn't positioned in the same way that it was in the killing of Annie Chapman. That's when we first started seeing that he was really positioning the body in a certain way. And then eventually, within 45 minutes, he kills Catherine Endos, 46 years old, on the 30th of September, 1888. That same day, 45 minutes later, this is a guy that knew his way around the city and that was angered by whatever happened with Elizabeth Stride. And had to make it right, in a sense. I know that's weird, but had to enact the perfect killing. And I do believe that that's what we saw in Meter Square from Catherine Endos. And I have a little section that I want to read from this book that just sort of describes the grim scene that was Catherine Endos' body. So she lay with both palms facing upwards, the fingers slightly bent, her right leg bent at the high knee and the left extended in a line with the body. There was great disfigurement of the face, and the throat was cut across to the extent of 6 or 7 inches. All the deep structures were severed to the bone, and there was a quantity of clotted blood on the left side of the neck, round the shoulder and upper part of the arm, which had flowed under the neck to the right shoulder, the pavement sloping in that direction. The upper part of the dress was torn open. The abdomen was laid open from the breastbone to the pubes. The intestines were drawn out to a large extent and placed over the right shoulder, were smeared over with some feculent matter, and were found twisted into the gaping wound on the right side of the murdered woman's neck. A piece of about 2 feet was quite detached from the body and placed between the body and the left arm, apparently by design. Whoever killed her had arranged the scene to await its discovery. Her uterus and left kidney had been removed, and the killer would seem to have taken them with him. Now, they also were able to discern that the offense, given the movement of police at that time, would have taken about 5 minutes. So that's what I mean by a crazed killer. Right. And this is why, you know, when we talk about Jack the Ripper, we have to say Jack the Ripper because of how gruesome these murders were. And there's a whole lot more that we have to get into, and we are going to get into it in part two. But what I want to touch on is that the final victim was Mary Kelly, and you mentioned that this was particularly grim.
It's horrifying, and I think it's the one that we have the clearest picture of.
Because she was in a bedroom.
November 9th, 1888. He was working some stuff out on her. It's also the only one that took place not on the street.
So he had more time.
So he had time, which is what freaks me out about Mary Kelly, because if that's what he did, given time and privacy and safety,
Right. I mean, and now
his head is a place I don't want to visit.
Let's hope we never, and that's the thing, we probably never will, because again, it's a totally unsolved case. Mm-hmm. That's all that we can get into right now when it comes to the victims. We have a whole much more to break into when it comes to victimology and evidence. You're gonna have to stick around for that in part two. We'll see you then.